My name is Bruce Hollinger, and I'm with WISIS. This is a first of a set of a video series to help explain the Developer SDK, which is a set of .NET objects that represent Makola business transactions, and to show how they can be used in a way to help automate your business. This diagram represents our technology stack or our application stack that makes up our total supply chain management solution that is built exclusively for Makola applications of Progression and Makola ES. Our developer SDK, which is what we're going to talk about in this video series, sits on top of the Makola database as the underlying framework to our overall product solution. It's made up of business transactions, Makola business transactions, that is a .NET object library, if you're thinking about this from a pure developer point of view. On top of that is the Agility Adaptable Framework, which is a rapid application development environment of which we build all the different application pillars that make up our supply chain management solution of order management, warehouse management, manufacturing execution, and shipping logistics. As I mentioned, this is a diagram of really a partial list of our object transactions by module. So we have object methods that are part of inventory and bill of material, things like inventory transactions, bill of material management. Under orders, we do order create, and order create objects are quite robust. They support all the different parameter options that would drive the order process that you would see as part of order management setup. So things like order create would create pop pull or shop floor pull items if need to be. We would capture bills. We could create customers, support pick ship bill options. We do billing, invoicing, confirm shipping, all the things you would need to create objects to manage the order, the entire OE management process in Makola. The same thing goes with purchase order, including things like doing landed costs, shop floor outside processes, multi-currency for both OE and PO. Our POP product is a little bit different than Makola POP product in terms of the objects that we provide. We work more on a shop floor type model. We do create standard POP orders and release those orders like in Makola, but we also provide the ability to do material issues and returns, item substitutions, and things that are a little bit extended from what the POP model would provide. We will backflush material as well, as does shop floor. Shop floor would do standard material issue return, creating orders. We would report operations or finished goods, scrap, reject, backflush material, backflush labor. So this library is quite robust in its feature set. We also support bins, serial lots, as a layer across all transactions. We support average cost, standard cost, and we do some last costing, but I don't think almost any customers I can think of is actually using the last cost model in Makola. And our objects are transparent to Makola ES and Makola Progression. You just point the methods of each transaction towards a database and a server, and we detect which kind of data, which kind of version of Makola that you're using. The parameters and properties to all of these transactions and methods is also transparent. They're all normalized to work both across Makola ES and Progression. Our object technology is it's not just a matter of writing transactions, Makola transactions to Makola tables. There's a lot more two, building an ERP-type scalable transactional model. First off, the transactions have to be very scalable. They need to be very fast. The transaction performance needs to equal or exceed the underlying ERP product. We need to support transaction control so that if a transaction ends up in a lock collision or cannot complete because of an error, then that transaction needs to be able to do an effective rollback. And it needs to support McCullough locking control. McCullough locking control is important in terms of detecting locks in McCullough and the Mac lock table, if you're familiar with that table. That's the logical locking control of McCullough. We write those locking records just exactly the same way as McCullough does. You'll notice sometimes in McCullough you'll receive a lock record in way. If we run into a lock record the same way in a business transaction, then we will detect that lock as well. Rich feature set support is really important. It's one thing to be able to create a basic order with some allocation records. But again, there's lots of features that make up order entry, how it goes about doing pricing. There's several different ways of commission calculations. There's regular tax codes versus tax schedules. There's different types of ways of doing terms management. So these are features that are parameterized throughout McCullough, both in the OE product, the inventory product, the purchase order product, lots of parameterized ways that these products can run. And our feature sets are very, very robust. We also are working on a roadmap to continue to expand that feature set. Feature sets are also added as part of our bug reporting process. Sometimes people find features that we just weren't sure were there or were missing in the first place, and many times we just add those as part of supporting our customer base. You can also combine transactions together to form a new composite transaction. A case in point would be POP reporting does not have the concept of a scrap report. So if you combined an inventory, say, issue with an inventory report and linked those transactions together, you could create a whole new transaction that never existed in McCullough before. The objects can be used either in .NET Visual Studio, or they can be called from VBA, which I'll show in a future video series of how you can do that in both .NET and VBA, such as using flexibility. And they need to be reliable. We have over 120 automated tests that we run prior to each build release. This is what we call a composite transaction. Again, I'm working with production order processing. Production order processing will, if you want to effectively create and report and produce a POP order, you would have to go through multiple steps, maybe several screens, to do that process. What if you really just wanted to report production on an item that you knew it was already produced? You wanted to go ahead and create the POP order, release the POP order, and produce the POP order all in one step. And there's no transaction in McCullough to do that. So we could combine that into one business transaction. You could just call all three together. You would keep them together in the same transaction call, and you would either commit or roll back that call, all as if it was one brand new McCullough business transaction. There's lots of ways of using the .NET object library. I'm going to talk about many of these, but if you were going to build an unattended process, you could use SQL Server Integration Services with SQL 2008 R2 and build quite robust .NET applications that actually could be run as SQL jobs, and I'm actually going to show you how you can do that. You could also write an unattended process using a Windows service. We have many clients using our products as e-commerce links to pump transactions into McCullough across from an e-commerce shopping cart to create orders and manage customers. You could build a Windows Forms application, or basically just a Windows desktop executable. Or we have people building web services. These are just different ways that you can call the objects from Microsoft's development libraries or development tools. To give you an example of a couple of these, I'm going to, in a future video series, actually show you how to use SSIS to actually build an actual functional transaction, business transaction. In this case, a customer of ours, Marco, actually used SSIS to do nighttime jobs to turn some inventory issues into transfers. It was a process. I'm not quite sure I can explain the whole process, but they wanted an automated process every night to come in and pick up these daily transactions and do additional transactions based on comment fields and order fields and things that were in the inventory transaction set. So they merely did a select statement and ran a SQL script, which was, it's really a .NET VSTA script, and then pumped the output to an audit trail, which we'll do later on in another video series. This was another example of something a little more robust done by Red Deer Systems, a McCullough reseller on the West Coast. They started with a web service to do quoting. They wanted to be able to enter quotes outside the firewall and automatically generate those quotes using the objects in the McCullough database. Then they wanted to view the quote orders, convert them to orders, and then even then, they built a fairly robust order management system so you could edit those orders using our objects. And this is something I'm going to hit on a couple times here, that our objects are more than just a way of batch transacting in McCullough. They're actually meant to build applications. They're meant to be set up in a way that you can communicate with the objects, get error returns, and communicate back and forth, and actually create desktop applications. So in this case, these orders created pop pull items, and then Red Deer wrote an application to read through those unreleased pop orders and then release them. This is another order entry system that was done by Essential Business Systems. In the next video series, I'm going to go through an example of how we can use this desktop application, this order entry system, to actually enter an order and process pop production orders through the business objects. So that's the end of this video series, and I hope you move on to the next video series where I'll actually show you some examples of how these objects work. Thank you.